as I told you, like we have first accounting standard to be started, and prior to that, let's complete this small topic that is on accounting errors, suspense accounts, and control accounts. So, in accounting, there can be mistakes. There can be mistakes of various type where the bookkeeper can make mistakes. And in addition to that, there could be various other factors that contributes towards making mistake. Okay, so accounting errors are the mistakes committed in bookkeeping and in accounting. So when you say bookkeeping, bookkeeping means recording the transactions, journalizing those part. Then accounting means where you post it or you record it in a different accounts. Those kind of errors are also committed by the bookkeeper or the accountant. So the mistake may be one relating to routine or one relating to principle. Okay, so what do you mean by routine is, it can happen every day, or maybe say it can happen every other day. But there could be mistakes where it is fundamentally wrong. Okay, as per the accounting rules, the entries have not been posted or journalized. So that may relate to the principle. We will go through it what it is. Then these accounting errors may occur in entering the transactions in the journal or subsidiary books. So when I say subsidiary books, now you already know the primary books, or they may creep at the time of posting into the ledger. So we have already learned the accounting process. So in that process, one of the steps is where you go and post the transaction into the ledger. So even at that level, there could be mistakes. So therefore, the errors may be committed while recording, classifying, or summarizing the accounting transactions. So these are the instances where the errors could happen. So let's look at the first type of errors. First one could be the clerical error. Clerical error means, now those days we call the person who is doing the bookkeeping function or the accounting function as a clerk. Now even for banks, those days they call it as a bank clerk. Why? That person is used to record transactions and keep records of all the transactions that happen. So the job of that person was more or less a clerical job. So now, for accounting purposes, what they say is an error committed by this clerk is known to be a clerical error. Now, why this clerk is making errors? Now, over the time, the businesses have grown and the volumes of transactions have grown. So as a result, the business and the volumes of transactions have come very tedious. So a person who is doing bookkeeping in an organization, like let's assume it's a bank. So in good old days, they were doing it. But now in today's context, if you look at the volume of transaction, it is too huge. So the clerk may not be able to handle the job of bookkeeping. Due to the tedium of job, sometimes what they do is, tend to do is, they might omit certain transactions, or say they might post some transaction incorrectly. So these type of errors are known as clerical errors. Now, one of the biggest reasons for computer systems to be introduced is this, because they wanted to eliminate the human intervention when recording transactions, or maybe say in the bookkeeping function. Okay, so as a result, they wanted to eliminate the human intervention into the transactions. It is at minimum level now we get involved. So you are given menu-driven systems to do the transactions even without going and entering any numbers or anything to select options. So it's like a menu driven thing that we do today. The second type of error is the ignorance. What do you mean by ignorance is the accountant or the bookkeeper does not know the distinction between an asset and an expenditure. What do you mean by this? You know that an asset, by nature, it is a debit balance. An expenditure is also a debit balance, or a transaction when you enter or transaction for these two, both will be debits. So as a result, at the time of performing the transaction or entering the transaction or posting the transaction, the person who is handling it might not know the difference between whether it is an asset or an expenditure. So I think it is the right time that we are going to learn the next topic, which will give you a clear indication of distinction between the asset and the expenditure. Because the next topic is that we are going to learn. Third type of error is where you make a fraud. Fraud is something purposely done, omitting to account for receipts or paying fictitious vouchers. It could be both. We always think that taking money or maybe misleading is a fraud. No. Sometimes what happens, you may accept a deposit, but you don't account for it. Secondly, you can pay to somebody where the authenticity of the documents are not correct or not true. So a fraud can be committed in any way. So we have to identify those kind of frauds. That's why the banks have much more detailed internal control procedures to try and minimize the level of frauds. You can't eliminate frauds, but you can minimize the level of frauds. Then we come to the double entry error. Double entry error is where you fail to post an amount entered in a book of prime entry. Now, you know, first we record it in the prime entry books. So from the prime entry books, we take it into the main ledger. Now, suppose if there is an amount in the sales day book. So from the sales day book, how do you account for it? You will debit debtors and credit sales. Now in one particular month, you forget to do this, or you totally missed this particular transaction. So that could be a double entry error where you have failed to post an amount entered in the book of prime entry. Error of commission is posting to an incorrect account of the correct class. Now please note here the class, correct class. What do you mean by that? Now when there is an expenditure, if you have identified that as an expenditure, that will be the correct class. Now within this correct class, let's assume that there is a transaction where you have paid the telephone charges for the month. Now, the person who is recording this transaction has to select the telephone charges account, debit telephone charges and credit cash. Instead of debiting telephone charges, if this person goes and debits some other account, say electricity charges, then what happens? It will become an error of commission where you debit an incorrect account of the correct class. Yes, electricity charges is also an expense account, but you debit the wrong account. You debit the wrong account. Somewhat similar to that, initially we were talking about some errors being based on principle. Now this is something like that. Posting to an account of an incorrect class. Now this is something different. Now you have identified an expenditure, but the person who is recording the transaction is not sure whether this is a expenditure or an asset. Now what does this person do? He goes and debits an asset account. He goes and debits an account, asset account. So now what is happening? He has posted to an account where it is not the correct class. Why? The correct class should have been expenditure. But this person goes and debits the asset account. So what do you mean by that? Posting to an account of an incorrect class. Incorrect class. So all these errors that we have looked at could happen at the stage of posting. You can go back and check. All these errors can happen at the time of posting the transaction. Posting the transaction to the ledger accounts. Now let's look at the second type of errors. Error of omission. Error of omission is where you failure to enter both the debits and credits. You totally ignore the transaction. Possible. Say for example, you accept a deposit from a customer where the customer is in a hurry. So he comes over to the counter and gives you the deposit slip and the cash, but he doesn't wait for the counter for it. So what happens? Since there is a long queue, you accept this particular deposit and keep it on one side, and you go to the next transaction. Now these vouchers and the cash are on one side where you forget to post that transaction. Now in banks, what happens? You have controls. You have controls. Now end of the day, what you do? You have to balance your cash position with the balance that is shown in the system. System will show you what is the cash amount that you should be having at the end of the day. So when you reconcile this cash amount, the physical cash amount that you have with the system balance, you might see a difference. Then you have to go back and check all your transactions and records and see whatever there are any missing transactions. If there is, then you have to account for it. Okay. So that is error of omission. Then there could be an entry error, entering and posting an incorrect amount. So the transaction that you are supposed to post is 100,000, but you post 10,000. That's an incorrect amount. Error of duplication. These are very straightforward. Error of duplication is entering the same transaction twice. That is very much possible because you might enter a transaction, again you go and enter the same transaction again. Now, this is why in banks, when you do the transaction, you do a validation where you put the deposit slip or withdrawal slip to the validator printer and you take a validation. So once you have validated means, you know that the transaction is already done. But just imagine somebody doing the bookkeeping manually. When you do manual bookkeeping, what happens? You might enter a transaction once. If you have not marked any notification, again, you might do the same transaction. So that could be error of duplication. And this could happen at the stage of making the prime entry, where you take it from the prime entry books and enter it into the general ledger. Third set of error is where you failure to include an account balance in the trial balance. Now we have already learned trial balance. So from the ledger, you extract a list of balances. You will have to list all the accounts and extract the balances from the ledger, right? So what happens when you fail to include an account balance in the trial balance? Obviously your trial balance won't balance. Your debit total won't balance with the credit total. That is a fundamental mistake. Then, stating the amount wrongly in the trial balance. What do you mean by that? You pick from the ledger the account sales. Now, sales, what kind of a balance it is? It's a credit. But you go and enter it in the debit column. You know sales is a credit balance, but you go and put it into the debit column. Now, this kind of an error could happen even at your examination. Even at your examination, where you might have seen the question number one, where sometimes even in September 2019, there the first question is where you have to prepare a trial balance. So from the question paper, you take an amount and you put it into the column where it should have been debit, but you put it in the credit column. What will happen? When you total the two columns, it won't tell you. Then you might be going back and checking over and over and again. But fortunately, if you find it, yes. But if you forget it over and over again, then you will be there with the same error for a longer time. Okay? So you have to be very careful when you are doing the exam question on trial balance. You have to clearly identify first what is the type of class it is. Now, we did it in the class where I wanted you to identify whether it is asset, liability, income, expense, or capital. Then, based on that, you know whether it is a debit balance or credit balance. So, thereafter only, you have to pick it and write it into the trial balance. So, here what they are saying is stating the amount wrongly in the trial balance. Wrongly means you put it in the wrong side. Sorry. Stating the amount wrongly in the trial balance means you pick it from the list of accounts or maybe the amount correctly, say 50,000, but when you go and enter it, you put it as 5,000. That is one type of error. The second type of error is putting it into the wrong side. Where it should have been debit, you go and put it into the credit side. When this could happen, this is at the stage of extracting a trial balance. Okay. Now, apart from the first two types of errors, that is at the stage of posting and making an entry from the prime entry books, this type of error, that is at the stage of extracting a trial balance, nowadays is very remote. Why I say that is nowadays the trial balance is produced from the system, computer system. So, the computer system is programmed in such a manner where it will pick the correct balance, it will pick it from to the correct side, it can't exclude any account. So, obviously, your trial balance cannot be in error. Okay? So, you need to know, even though we learned the theory, you have to know the practical side of it. Now, if you look at today's context, when you are extracting a trial balance from the system, these three types of errors, it does not happen. Does not happen unless your computer system has a failure. If the computer system, if it is the accounting tool is configured in such a manner, you can't have all these three errors. That is, the system will not exclude any account into the trial balance. It won't state the amount wrongly, it won't state on the wrong side also. Okay, but these errors from a theoretical perspective, it is there. Okay, right. Now, even in exams, in your exams, this type of questions are there. Sometimes what happens, you extract the trial balance and the trial balance doesn't balance. The trial balance doesn't balance. So it might happen. So in such a instance, what will you do? You cannot be waiting for a long time without proceeding further because the financial reporting has to happen. So what do we do in such a instance? Sometimes we go and do certain adjustments. Okay. So that we will learn subsequently when we complete these errors. Next one is compensating error. Compensating error is accounting entries that do not disturb the balancing of the trial balance. Okay. Now, you accept a deposit of 10,000 where you don't enter the transaction. Then there is a withdrawal also for 10,000. Now, when you accept a deposit, what will happen? Debit cash, credit the customer. Then when there is a withdrawal of 10,000, what will happen? You will debit a customer and credit cash. Now, in both instances, if you don't record this transaction properly or you don't post the transactions, what will happen? It will set off against one with the other. Why? Both the transactions are 10,000 rupees. In one instant, you are debiting cash. In one instant, you are crediting cash. So both will get set off. End of the day, there is no impact. But if the two customers check their accounts, what will happen? The customer who is supposed to get the credit hasn't got it. The customer who should lose the 10,000 rupees from his account has not got it. So in banks, even we work with the computer system, this type of an error can happen. So that's why you have to be very careful when you are doing the cash related transactions. Okay. So we learned that from the trial balances, whether the trial balance agree, the debit total and the credit total agree, we can't say that the trial balance is perfect. Okay, because now even when the trial balance is balanced, you can have all these errors. You can have all these errors. So you have to be very careful when you are preparing your financial statement, because it has to be free from all these errors. It has to be free from all these errors. Okay. And the next type of error is where we call it as transposition error. So transposition error is where accounting entries that do not disturb the balancing of the trial balance, but those are errors, right? So this transposition error happens when you have misposted an amount. I will explain how it is. This is one example. Now, you know, when you are posting transactions, sometimes you post the amount interchangeably. Instead of 16, you put 61. Instead of 35, you put 53. Instead of 59, you put 95. It can happen, because humanly we can make this mistake. So when you make this mistake, what happens? Your trial balance won't balance. Your trial balance won't balance. That is, the debit total will not match with the credit total. So there will be a difference between the debit and the credit. Now what we do is, even this can happen in the examinations. Please be aware of that. So that's why I'm specifically stressing this point. You have to be very careful when you are doing it in exam. The balance that you are taking from the question paper has to be written properly in the answer book, because you cannot be going over and over again looking at the question. Once you have written it in the answer book, you will work on based on that amount. So you have to be very careful from what you are taking from the question paper and what you are writing into the answer book. So when there is a difference where the debit total does not agree with the credit total, but first what you have to do is you have to check the difference. The difference between the debit total and the credit total. Okay, right. So if there is a difference, let's assume the difference is 12,690. That is what I have put here, an example. Now, this 12,690 has 5 digits. That is 12690. What we do is we have to total all those digits, like what I have shown here, 1 plus 2 plus 6 plus 9. Of course, 0. No need to add it again. When you add it, you get 18. Then you have to further add it. 1 plus 8. And you get 9. So if the addition of the digits in the difference adds up to number 9 finally, then you can conclude there is a transposition error. Okay, let me say it again. You total the debits and the credits in the trial balance, and if there is a difference, let's assume the difference is 12,690. What you do? You take all the single digits in that answer, the difference, 1 plus 2 plus 6 plus 9 plus 0. then you it add up to 18. Again, you further add it. 1 plus 8, you get 9. If your final answer is 9, which means there is a transposition error, then what you need to do? You need to go back to your tunnel balance once again, check all the amounts. Now, this can practically happen in your examination. So, you have to be very careful. That's why I'm repeating it. If something happens, you have to go back and check all your balances once again. What you have taken is correct or not. Okay? Right. So, these are the possible scenarios where the transposition error could happen. There can be only 9 scenarios. You can look at this. The difference could be always of this kind. 9, 18, 27, 36, 45, 54, 63, 72, and 81. So, which means all ends up in number 9. Number 9. So, as I told you, the ultimate result of the trial balance being having a difference could end up creating a stoppage in the financial reporting process, because when there is a trial balance which does not balance, you can't proceed further. Okay, because the trial balance has to agree for you to do a financial reporting or preparing financial statements or whatever. So the first thing that you have to do is you have to ensure the trial balance must balance. Now, if the trial balance doesn't balance, what do we do is we initially park it in an account called suspense account. That is why the suspense account is built up. Suspense account is a temporary account where you park a difference of this kind in a trial balance temporarily into this suspense account, and then you reconcile that suspense account. That suspense account. So suspense is actually associated with uncertainty because there is a difference, but you don't know what it is. So there is an uncertainty. So when this situation happens, what you do? You check the debit total and the credit total. There is a difference. And then you check whether there is a transposition error, as I mentioned to you earlier. If there is no transposition error, then the next step is you park it in a suspense account. The difference will be put to a suspense account on one of the sides, and then you proceed with the remaining reconciliation pertaining to the suspense account. So upon detecting the error, what will happen? You will clear the suspense account from the balance that you have parked. Okay, if you have put 20,000 in the suspense account, once you have discovered the suspense account differences, you will clear that 20,000 and you can proceed with the financial reporting. Now, in examination, that type of questions have come where you have to use the suspense account and they will give you some adjustments. When you do the adjustments, the suspense account will be wiped off. Okay. So, when you want to wipe off the suspense accounts, there will be journal entries required where you have to post double entries to ensure that the suspense account is cleared. Okay. So, that is all about accounting errors and suspense accounts. If you have any questions, you can ask. Are there any questions? Okay, so what we'll do is we will get on with the next topic. I think I hope the, both the tutes are made available in the portal. You have both the tutes,
yes,
right?
Sir.
So let's get on to the next topic, which is the topic that I was mentioning to you all. So let's get on to that topic, which is on property, plant and equipment, right? Which is the first accounting standard that we are going to go through. Very important standard. But in as far as your exam paper is concerned, there have been two instances where this has been tested as a separate question in essay type question. But other than that, it had been just coming in as an part of the first question, and in some instances it had come in the multiple choice. So anyhow, you have to know this subject, okay, because it will help you in even when you in your day-to-day transactions in your business also. So the standard that we are talking about is LKAS 16. The standard is LKAS 16, basically, right? So before we move on, I just want to show you all. Okay, hope you all can see the board.
Yes, sir.
Right. Now, this particular standard that we are talking about is LKS 16. It goes as LKS 16. So when we are talking about a standard, how we say that is, it goes as Sri Lanka Accounting Standard then you write this number, that is LKAS 16. So in examination, when you are required to write the name of a particular standard, always remember you have to write it like Sri Lanka Accounting Standard LKS 16, then you have the name of the standard. So in this case, this particular standard is property, plant and equipment. Property, plant and equipment. So let me yes, so I have that in the slide. So let's look at this. Now, if you look at it, this is how it comes. LKS 16, Sri Lanka Accounting Standard, LKS 16. So what is the name of the standard? That is property, plant and equipment. So if you write this entirely only, that relates to the name of the accounting standard. So LKS Sri Lanka Accounting Standard, LKS 16, colon, property, plant and equipment. Now in exams, what happens, candidates sometimes write only LK16. You won't get marks. Sometimes candidates write property, plant and equipment. No, you don't get marks. So as when you do the past paper questions, you will understand, just for writing the accounting standards, you get 5 marks. There had been instances. So you have to know how to write the accounting standard, Sri Lanka Accounting Standard, LKAS 16, colon, property, plant and equipment. That is how you should write your the accounting standards. And bear in mind, we will be learning a lot of standards during our course. So all standard, you should remember the name of the standard properly. Right. Going into the topic, what is the objective of this standard? This standard explains the accounting treatment for property, plant and equipment. So what do you mean by property, plant and equipment? Property means the land and buildings that you have. Every business has its own land and building. So now say your bank might be having a head office building and a lot of branches. Now sometimes what happens, your head office building must be one of your own buildings, but the branches could be on rented premises. And some banks, even they might have their head office also on rented premises. There is no issue about it. But generally what happens, the head office building will be one of your own property, which means the land and the building belongs to that particular company. Okay. Then you might also have plants. What do you mean by plants? Now, let's take an example of an apparel company, like Brandix or Mass Holdings. Now these companies have large plants. They have huge machineries which get involved in the production of apparels. So these machines also belong to the business. So there has to be a certain mechanism of accounting for these large plants and machinery. And the last part is equipment. Equipment means any furniture or other equipment. Say, for example, in your bank, you might be using a lot of computer equipment. So there is an accounting treatment as far as the computer equipment are concerned. Okay. So all in all, PPE means property, plant and equipment. There are three parts of fixed assets. We call this as fixed assets. So the three elements are: one is property, the second one is plant, and the third one is equipment. So in order to account for these three components of fixed assets, what is the standard that is applicable? The standard is LKS 16. What are the main features of this standard? Or maybe what are the main features of accounting for property, plant and equipment? Number one, we call it as recognition of assets. Number two, determination of its carrying amount. I will define all these what it is, but just number three, depreciation made. Number four, impairment losses to be recognized in relation to them. Okay. So now you see, when you are having a fixed asset, okay, now let's take, You are having a vehicle. So the vehicle is owned by you. It's your own vehicle. Now, when you purchase this vehicle, and after about a period of 5 years, do you expect the vehicle to be in the same condition as when you bought it? No, it won't happen. Because as and when you start using the vehicle, over a period of 5 years or maybe 10 years, it doesn't matter. What happens? There is a wear and tear. Just like the clothes. When we keep on wearing clothes, what will happen? It will get tear. So likewise, the fixed assets also, when you keep on using the assets, there is a diminution in value or reduction in value. Why? There could be repairs coming in, you have to do maintenance, lot of things are happening. So the property, plant and equipment, it all will have that issue. Even if your property, any plants or maybe any equipment, whatever it is, there will be a certain amount of wear and tear. Now, when you take the asset's life, it will go through all these phases. Initially, it will come into the company where you have to recognize the asset. What is the value? If you are buying a new building to your organization, what is the value of the building? That is recognition. Then after bringing it into your books, what is the value that you are going to carry forward? Whether it will be always 60 million or 50 million or it might change. Yes, that is your carrying amount. Then, as I told you, there will be a wear and tear. Then you have to account for that wear and tear. The mechanism to account for the wear and tear is called depreciation. We will learn that. What do you mean by depreciation is? Then you also have impairment losses to be recognized in relation to these. Now, I'm introducing the term impairment now, but we will learn in detail what is impairment is. Now, what do you mean by impairment? You might have purchased a computer today. Let's say it's worth 120,000. After a period of 5 years, obviously, this computer will be less in value. You can't say that it is still 120,000. No, it will be less in value. But in between, let's assume this computer get caught into a flood that happened in your branch. Now, what will happen? The computer is totally damaged. You try to do certain repairs, no, it cannot be done. At that time, what will happen? There will be a reduction in value of your computer. The reduction in your value of your computer is the impairment. If it was 120 due to this flood, if you assess it to be 100,000, that 20,000 is the impairment that we are talking about. So I don't want to go into detail without knowing the subject of impairment. Let's park it for the time being. And once we do the impairment, you will understand what it is. The scope. So LK 16, the accounting standard, should be followed when accounting for PPE. PPE stands for property, plant and equipment. We will use that abbreviation going forward. Unless another accounting standard requires a different treatment. Now, in your organization, you will have various kind of assets. Some of the assets may not be relating to fixed assets. Okay. So, as a result, what you need to do is, you have to identify what is the standard that is covering this asset. Okay. So, for example, if you have some PPE, that PPE should be covered by this LK 16. If it is covered by some other standard, then you should not apply LK 16. I will give you some examples. LK 16 does not apply to the following. Just look at it, how this works. Biological assets related to agricultural activity. Now, let's take an example. There is a tea plantation. You know, the tea plantation companies are there, whatever the plantation, or maybe the rocket plantation. There are a lot of plantation companies are there. Now, when you look at the plantation sector companies, what are their fixed assets? What are their fixed assets? Now, they must be having their office. They must be having their tables and chairs and computers. They might be having their machines which grinds the tea leaves and prepare tea. Right? All those are their fixed assets. But what is the main source of fixed asset as far as these tea plantation companies are concerned? The tea plants, the tea estates, where they grow tea plants. What about these tea plants? Do they fall into the category of fixed asset or not? That is the question that we have. Now, when you take such an example, where when you say biological asset, that is a biological asset. The tea plants that involve, maybe say you have a land which has coconut trees. Now, the coconut trees are assets for you. But the problem is whether it is a fixed asset whether it is a fixed asset.
No.
Why? Because biological assets related to agricultural activity are covered by a different standard. There are separate accounting standards applicable for biological assets. So, which is not in scope of our syllabus. We don't have to learn it because that is for people who are in the business of agricultural activity. Okay, so you don't have to worry. But what you need to understand is LKA 16 will not apply for biological assets. When you have biological assets, it won't apply to the LK 16 won't apply to the biological assets. Then the second example is mineral rights and mineral reserves such as oil, gas and other non-regenerative resources. Now there are oil companies, right? Or maybe say where they are involved in mining, gas, or maybe mineral reserves. Now these companies also will have a problem, right? They seem to be part of their fixed assets, but LKA 16 does not apply to them. They have a separate accounting standards for the accounting treatment of these type of mineral reserves such as oil, gas, or maybe any other. Then, most importantly, any property, plant, and equipment that is classified as held for sale. Can anyone think about an example of what is property, plant, and equipment held for sale? Now let's look at a real estate company. You might have seen a lot of real estate companies. What do? They purchase a bigger land plot, say maybe 5 acres or 10 acres. They buy a plot of land. Then what do? When they purchase that land, it belongs to them because land and building is part of your fixed assets. But the problem here is the land purchased by them is not for their own use. They will not use that land. What they will do is they will divide this land into small pieces of land where we call them as land plots, and they will sell them. That is what you will see, these land sales where there are a lot of companies selling land plots. So that kind of a business, we call it as, it is held for sale. Where this property is not for the own use, but for selling purposes. Now say, for example, there are a lot of companies who are constructing condominiums. These condominiums are constructed and it is their own property. But what do? End of the construction, they sell it to the public. There are units where you sell it to the public. So each individual can buy those units. Once you have decided and defined it as something which is held for sale, LKA 16 will not apply. Because once you have decided it to be something that is held for sale, it is not property, plant, and equipment. That is what we are trying to highlight here. Now let's get on with some definitions. Do you have any questions by this time? Any questions?
Excuse me, sir. Will we get this in the accounting thing, like will they say to apply these kinds of theory and make the practical thing?
That is in examination.
In examination.
I don't think that they will want you to identify whether PP this PP standard applies or not. Those kind of questions won't come. But this is just for knowledge that we are learning. But in examination, what will happen is they will use the practical side of the standard. Whether you know to calculate depreciation, whether you know the definitions pertaining to certain element that we are going to learn now, how to do a disposal. Those type of practical ones only will be tested. You won't get to test whether this the standard will apply to this or not. Those kind of things won't come. Don't worry. Okay, that is what your question was, right? So let's continue with the. So let's look at the definitions now. There are a lot of definitions which you have to know, but I would say that you should not be memorizing the definitions. Don't try to memorize the definitions, but see whether you can remember those and write it in your own words, right? Okay, the first one, the definition of property, plant and equipment. What do you mean by property, plant and equipment? Property, plant and equipment means any tangible assets. Tangible assets, very important term, tangible asset, that are held for use in the production or supply of goods or services, or for rental, or for other administrative purpose. Now, very simple. Let me put it in like this. What you can call as a property, plant and equipment is something which is the tangible asset. What do you mean by tangible? Yeah, you can touch and feel. Touch and feel. Say a computer, you can touch and identify that is a computer. A building, you can see and you can say that this is a building. Tables and chairs, you can touch and say that this is a table and a chair. Now, all these are called tangible assets. All these are called tangible assets. So, tangible asset means anything that you can touch and feel. Any asset that you can touch and feel. Now, you should not be asking the question, for example, cash. Now, if I give you cash, you can touch and feel it. But can we call it as a property, plant and equipment? No, it doesn't fall into the category of property, plant and equipment. So that is a separate thing where cash is identified as a separate element in your business. But what we are trying to establish here is any asset, fixed type of asset, whether it belongs to property, plant and equipment or not. So, property, plant and equipment means it's a tangible asset. What kind of an asset it is? It is held for the purpose of using it in the production or supply of goods or services. Now, what do you mean by this is, let's take the bank that you are working in. In your respective banks, you have the branch building, you have the counters, partitions, and then you are seated on a chair and you are given a table. You have been given a computer. Now, for what purpose are we using all these? This is to provide a financial service. A financial service. So, all these assets or the tangible assets that are available in your organization are being used to produce a service. Are being used to produce a service. So if that is the case, then that asset can be called as a property, plant and equipment. Okay. Sometimes what happens, you might have a building. This building, you don't want to use it, but you want to give it on rent. You can give it on rent. A lot of people do that. They construct a building and they give it on rent. Now, say for example, most of your branch buildings must be on rent. So as a result, that building is a fixed asset for the person who has rented it, but not for you, because you are paying a rent and working in the, or maybe occupying that building. So it's a not a fixed asset for you, but for the person who has rented it out to you. Okay, so you have to be very careful. Now, if let's say you have 200 branches, out of the 200 branches, only 50 branches are operating in your own building. Rest of the 150 branches are on rented premises. Now, the 50 branches only, the buildings will be your property, plant and equipment. The balance 150, it does not belong to you. But the computers that are working in those 200 branches belongs to you. Why? Those computers are being used to produce the financial service. So what do you mean by property, plant and equipment is any tangible asset that is used to provide a service or to produce production, for production. Now say for example, the apparel company, they might be having large machines. Those machines can be called as fixed assets or property, plant and equipment. Why? Those machines will be used to produce apparel. So when you are using it to produce apparel means that is part of your fixed assets. The most important part of the definition is these assets are expected to be used during more than one period. Now, what do you mean by more than one period? By now, you know what is the accounting period is. Accounting period means generally it's a financial year. It's a financial year that we are talking about. So in this financial year, you will have fixed assets. But when do we call them as fixed assets? When you are using it for more than 1 year. It has to go beyond one particular year. If that is the case, then we can consider that as a property, plant and equipment. Very important. So I hope this definition is very clear to you with regard to property, plant and equipment. So the second definition that we are going to look at is the cost and the fair value. Cost and the fair value. What do you mean by cost and what do you mean by fair value? Now these two are very important because the term fair value and the term cost, we will be using it in various other places. In the future subjects that we are going to learn, chapters that we are going to learn, these two terms will come into play. So you need to know what is cost and what is fair value. Let's look at what is cost. Cost is the amount of cash or cash equivalent paid or the fair value of other consideration given to acquire an asset at the time of its acquisition or construction. So simply, what do you mean by this? This is like a technical definition, but what do you mean by this? When you buy an asset, acquisition means you purchase or you buy. When you buy a fixed asset, what do you need to do? You need to pay for it. So the price that you pay to acquire an asset is known as cost. The price that you pay to acquire an asset will be known as the cost. Okay. Similarly, fair value is the amount for which an asset could be exchanged between knowledgeable willing parties in an arm's length transaction. Now, this is something different. Initially, when you go and buy an asset, the price that you pay is cost. Now, in turn, if you want to sell this asset to another party, there should be a value, which we normally call as the market value. I think you might have heard this term, market value. For every product, there is a market value. Now, this market value should not have any biasness. It should be free from any biasness. What do you mean by that? There are two parties. These two parties are knowledgeable, should be knowledgeable. Knowledgeable means they should know about the market price of this product or maybe this asset. And they should be in a position to willingly transact. Now, you should not force the other person and make them to buy your product. No, that is wrong. They should come and willingly purchase your asset. If that is the case, then the value that you assign for the product is known as a fair value. A fair value. That is what is called as a fair value. Now, let's look at this example so that you will understand what it is. Okay. Now, let's take two parties. You have a building. You have a building, right? You are the owner. So you are trying to sell it to another person. That's another person who is going to buy this. Okay. The building is currently in your books. What is there in your books is called as the cost. Cost means the value that you have paid. You have paid means now if it is a building that you have constructed, you have might have spent for material, raw material, labor, all those. So let's say this building, the cost is 10 million, just for example, 10 million. So this building is worth 10 million for you. Now you have decided to sell this building property. So you have found a person. Now this person should be knowledgeable. Knowledgeable means he should know the market conditions. A building which is located in, let's say, Colombo. Let's say Colombo 10, for example. What is the building price in an area in Colombo 10? I'm just taking an example. So this person should have an idea about this. That is what we mean by being knowledgeable. Secondly, this person should be willing to buy this. You can't go and force this person to buy this property. No. Then it will be under influence. This transaction has to happen freely. That is what we call it as at arm's length. There shouldn't be anything forced on this person to buy this property. So one is this person should be knowledgeable about the market prices. Secondly, this person should be willing to purchase this building. Right. Now you quote a price. You say, look, this property is, I'm going to sell this at 15 million. I'm going to sell it at 15 million. But you know the building is not worth 15. Let's say you make it 20. Right. You say 20 million, but you know that this building actually doesn't worth 20 million. in that region, it is going at 15 million. Okay. Now this person says, look, the buildings in this area, I'm just taking an example, does not go in the range of 20 million for a land extent of this much. This I can pay you about 15 million. This person now is knowing their price, so he is saying, I can give you around 15 million. That could be the best price. Okay. So if it is 15 million, now you think that, okay, now I have quoted 20 million, but this person is asking for 15 million. What is happening here? There is a bargaining happening. But you say, no, I can't give you at 15 million. The last that I can give you at is 17 million. Okay. So this person again goes and checks from his friends, from the surrounding, what is the current price that is going at. And he agrees to buy it at 17 million. Agrees to buy it at 17 million. Now, this 17 million becomes the fair value of the property. Fair value of the property. So what you mean by here is, fair value is none other than the market value. Market value. Market value means what is accepted by the public in that region, or the known price for the same kind of a product. So here, for this particular building, what do we say? The accepted market price of this building is 17 million. Maybe in the range of 17 million. You can't be exactly saying the price, but in the range of 17 million. So if that is the case, then this 17 million becomes the fair value of that particular asset. The fair value of that particular asset. Now, in businesses, you have to be mindful, the concept of fair value is mostly applicable for land and buildings. Now, say for example, you have a chair. You have used this chair for, let's say, 3 years. Now, after 3 years, if you are asking about a fair value, that is not practical. Because for chairs, if you ask for a fair value, it doesn't matter. I mean, practically, it won't make any sense. Because every other year, time, you when you go and ask for a price of the chair, it would have changed. So, for assets such as chairs, computers, and so on, we'll not be practical to think about a fair value. But land, building, which is falling under the category of property, and then large machinery, which is falling under the category of plant, is subject to fair value. Those can be considered under the concept of fair value because those are large valued assets, large valued assets. But small valued assets, we don't talk about a fair value. But if there is a significant reduction in value, then we have to think about the fair value. Is that understood? The cost and the difference between the fair value? Because later on, when we go on, we will talk about the term fair value. So you shouldn't be asking at that time what is fair value is. That's why I am explaining it in detail for you to understand what is fair value, because there will be so many other topics that we will learn. There, I will simply use the term fair value. So you should be able to differentiate between what is cost and what is fair value.
Can you explain again that what is the cost amount?
I will explain. Understood, right?
Yes, sir.
Right. Now we'll look at the cost. Good that you asked that question, because then it will be easy for me to explain it all. Right. Let's look at what is cost. Now, cost, the definition of cost, even though it is like that, we will add some more to it. So I will give you an example now. clear example. Let's say, may not be the best example, but we'll take it. Let's say Brandy's, right? You know, this is an apparel company. And what do? They manufacture apparel, right? So this is a company which uses large machinery for their production. Their main business is producing apparel and exporting them to foreign countries. But how they produce them, that is using a large machinery that they have in their warehouses or maybe in the manufacturing factory. So what happens, let's assume they are now looking for a large machinery. So this machinery is available only in Germany. So the machinery is available only in Germany. You have to buy it from Germany and bring it down. So you talk to a company in Germany and you agree on a price. So German might quote in a different price value, but we will consider it in rupees, right? So let's say the rupee equivalent of this machinery quoted by this company price is, let's say, 15 million. The large machine price is 15 million. So what do you do? You will have to go for an arrangement of, you have to open an LC in your bank, and then you will request this seller from the Germany to sell it, send it through a vessel to Sri Lanka. So now he has agreed and he will now put it into a vessel and this will now come through the sea, right? Now this machine is worth 15 million. Okay? So you have agreed to pay it. So the price of this machine is now 15 million. According to the definition that we looked at short while ago, what do you mean by the cost? Cost is the price or the cash or cash equivalent consideration. Consideration means the amount that you pay is considered as the cost. Okay, so the cost of the machinery for Brand X is 15 million. Cost of the machinery for Brand X is 15 million because they have to pay 15 million to get this machinery down. Okay. I'm trying to explain a little bit further, which will be useful for us later on. Now, this machine has to come through the sea. Now, bringing down a machinery through the sea is subject to various risk factors. You know, anything can happen to the ship that is coming in, or maybe there could be damages. So many things can happen. So what will happen? You need to now insure this particular machinery to see that it is coming safe to Sri Lanka. So you now try to get an insurance. Sometimes some of the transaction, this company might do the insurance part from their country to Sri Lanka. But sometimes what happens, you will have to pay for the insurance also. Now let's assume that you pay marine insurance. We call it as marine insurance. You pay marine insurance, let's say 3 million. Because it's a huge value, you have to pay that amount, 3 million. Now the machinery has come to the Sri Lankan port. Let's say Colombo port, right? It's now in the harbor. Now you have to clear it from there and bring it to where? Minuang Godal. You have to bring it to the Minuang Godal. Now how you are going to bring it? Will you bring it in a bus? Or you can bring it in a vehicle? No. You have to bring it through road transportation via container. Then, again, the same topic. You have to pay for transportation. This is subject to risk also. So you will pay transport plus insurance, both. But you have to get it down here to your factory. That will cost, let's say, 1 million. 1 million. This is a huge machine. The values will be somewhat like that. Now let's assume the machine has reached in Ongoda, their factory. Now, this is not an equipment where you can just plug and play, not just like a phone. Now we have brought it. Now this has to be installed. You have to install it and see whether it is in the expected working condition. If it is in the working condition only, you can make use of this machine in the production. So generally what happens is, when you are bringing down this kind of a machinery, if you don't have the expertise here, you have to bring down consultants from Germany. Okay, let's assume there are consultants who have come from Germany. So what will happen? These consultants will be involved in the installation. So these consultants have come down, now they will stay in hotel, their accommodation, food, the expenses that you will have to incur for installation, then there will be installation fee, consultation fee, all those put together 1 million. Okay? After doing all those, now the machinery is good to go. They can start producing t-shirts. Okay? Now only the asset, the fixed asset that was supposed to be there in Brandix, which will be used in the production of goods, is ready to go. Now, what is the cost? Now, what is the cost? That is the question. So the asset that came from Germany is only ready to use now. During this process, you had to pay for all these. You had to pay for all these. So in total, you have paid 20 million. Now the question is, what is the cost of this asset? Whether it is the 15 million that you paid or the 20 million that you see here. Theoretically, the cost of the asset is 20 million. Okay, that is the added definition that we will learn subsequently. When you measure an asset, the definition extends to go on to say that the asset that you have acquired or purchased, from that point to make it to in the workable condition or in bringing it into the working condition, all expenditure that you will incur will be part of your cost. I will define that later on. You will see, since you have asked this question, I have tried to explain it in one go. So basically, even though we say the cost is the acquisition price, now it will extend to this much to say that the whatever the price that you have paid to acquire this asset and any subsequent cost that you might have incurred to bring that asset to a workable condition or into a working condition, the cost that you might incur, the prices that you might pay, will be part of your cost. So the cost of this machinery would not be 15 million, but it will be 20 million. Is that clear?
Yes, sir.
Right. So we please make a note of this example, because this will be very useful. Later on, we will, I will just, I don't need to again explain this. You will understand this. So if you want, just take down this. Okay, right, so we'll get back to. So the theoretical definition says cost is the amount of cash or cash equivalent paid or the fair value of the other consideration given to acquire an asset at the time of its acquisition or construction, right? Later on, you will see there will be an extended definition to say that there will be all incremental costs that you have incurred to bring the asset into a workable condition is also part of the cost. The next definition is useful life. So what do you mean by useful life? The period over which a depreciable asset is expected to be used by the entity. Now this comes in by way of experience. The useful life is a judgment by the company. There is no standard to say that this should be the useful life. Now say when you take a human life, we call it as life expectancy is there. Say for normally gents, they say 72 years. So there is a life expectancy, age is there. You can call that to be the useful life. But when you look at fixed assets, those also will have to be defined with a useful life. To how long I can use this as per my judgment. When I say my judgment, the company's judgment, because they are the ones who are going to use it. So as per their judgment, what is the useful life of an asset? There is a term called depreciable asset here. Don't worry about it. We will learn that. That is coming up. So, let's say assume that I have purchased a computer today. Let's say 1 January 2021, I have purchased a computer. Now, based on my experience, I assume that I can use this computer for 5 years without any problem. After 5 years, this might start giving trouble where the I will observe certain slowness or various types of issues might come up. So as far as I am concerned, I will be assigning a useful life for the computer as 5 years. But another company where their usage may be very high, they use the computer heavily. So they say my useful life, as per my definition, the useful life for the asset is, computer is, only 3 years. Only 3 years. So I would say, as far as I'm concerned, my company decides that the computer can be used only for 3 years. So what is the problem here? Now, the useful life can change or may be different from one company to another, depending on their judgment. So please note that the LK16 is subject to a lot of judgments, lot of assumptions. Can you remember the chapter that we learned? on principles, assumptions, and concepts. So here, this is one topic where it will be subject to a lot of principles, assumptions, and there is a lot of subjectivity. Okay? Whatever the company thinks it is best for them, they will adopt it. So here, one element, you will decide on a useful life of fixed asset where it is the period over which a depreciable asset is expected to be used. How long you expect it to be used? The number of production or similar units expected to be obtained from the asset by the entity. Now, you can call it as in number of years. When you take a computer, you can say, I will use it for 5 years. But look at, going back to the example of what the machinery that was brought in by Brandix. Now, they can't say, I will make use of this machine for 10 years. That is not realistic. Because for a business of that kind, where they are into the manufacturing, they will not decide on a useful life based on the number of years. Because their usage will depend on with the level of production. So what do? They will say, I will use this machine till I produce 1 million units. 1 million units. Or maybe say, I would say 1 million t-shirts. I will make use of this machine till I produce 1 million t-shirts. Because they will get a confirmation from the company in Germany how long that you can use this machine. So they will say, you can produce 1 million units or 50,000 units. Up to 50,000 units, you will not have any problems. If there is a problem, we will replace the machine. That is the guarantee that you can get. So the German company will give you a warranty saying that you can use this machine until you produce 50,000 units without any problem. So what will I do? My definition of useful life for the machinery that I have will be not in terms of number of years. It will be the number of production or similar units expected to be obtained from the asset. Okay? So there could be two definitions. One is, you can define the useful life in terms of number of years, or you can define it in terms of number of production units that you expect to produce from this machine, okay, or from the asset. Now we talk about a residual value. Residual value. What do you mean by residual value? It is the net amount which the entity expects to obtain for an asset at the end of its useful life, after deducting the expected cost of disposal. After deducting the expected cost of disposal. So now, let's say, you are using an asset So you are using an asset, let's say, we'll take a computer, simple example. So this is Jan 2021, okay, Jan 2021, you have started using this and you are using it for 3 years. So 21, 22, 23. Now we are in 24, let's say. In 2024, what you decide, you want to get rid of this computer. You want to sell it off and want to go for a new one. So what you do? You purchase this computer for 120,000. So you have two options. One is, after using it for 3 years, you can give it to somebody freely, or you can give this to somebody at a lower price, because no one will buy it at 120 after 3 years now, because you have used it. So simply you can either give it free to somebody, or you can give it at a lesser price. Now the question here is, what is this lower price? Let's assume that if you are giving it at 10,000 rupees, if you are giving it at 10,000 rupees, that value is called the residual value. Residual value. But what is the issue here is, you will come to know this value only in 2024. But in accounting purposes, for accounting purposes, what you have to do is, you have to identify this amount here. The residual value has to be defined not here, but here. So what happens, companies, what they will do is, with their experience over the years, for every asset, they will try to define a residual value. They will try to define a residual value. But mostly what happens, they will define it as zero. Mostly the companies will define or assign a residual value of zero, which means they think like, by the time of 3 years, this will be zero. I can't sell it to anybody. I can just only give it for free. But some of the companies, what they do, they assume that, no, I can sell this at least for 10,000 rupees. Even though I bought it for 120, after 3 years, I can sell it for 10,000. So, the amount that we define here as the value that we expect to get after 3 years or maybe after the useful life is known as the residual value. After a period of the useful life, if you expect to get a value, that value you define here, and that is known as the residual value. Residual value. Okay. Any questions on that? Did you all understand what is residual value is? Is it clear with you all?
Yes, sir.
Fine. Because when you respond only, I can continue. Otherwise, I won't know that whether you have understood or not. Right. So residual value means is the net amount which the entity expects to obtain for an asset at the end of its useful life after deducting the expected cost of disposal. It could be a value estimated by the management. See, it is a value that could be estimated by the management. So your company will have to decide at the beginning of, or the maybe at the time of the purchase, you have to decide what is the residual value that I am going to assign. But keep in mind, generally, the companies assume it to be zero, generally, right? However, for exam purposes, if they have not mentioned about a residual value, if they have not mentioned about a residual value in the question, you have to assume that it is zero, okay? That is an assumption that you make. So in exams, what you do, if you get this type of question, if they have not mentioned about the residual value, you just make a note saying that I have assumed the residual value to be zero, and then you can do the question. Okay. Even without writing it, no problem, but just better if you can say that you have assumed the residual value to be zero if they have not given. Depreciable amount. So this is the this is what we have been talking about here. Under useful life, we were talking about the depreciable amount. So that is what we are now going to look at. Depreciable amount. It is the cost of an asset or other amount substituted for cost less its residual value. Its residual value. So the value which will be subject to wear and tear. That is what we are talking about. When you look at an asset, we say that that asset will be subject to wear and tear because you will keep on using it. What is that amount? That is what we are trying to establish. So if you look at it, I'll just explain it on the board so that it will be easy for you. Now we said this computer will be used for 3 years and the cost is 120 and the residual value that you expect after 3 years is 10,000. Okay. Now the question is, what is the depreciable amount? So the depreciable amount for the wear and tear will be depreciable amount DA will be equal to 120 minus 10,000, which means 110,000. So this 110,000 only will be considered as the depreciable amount. For my calculations, what I will use in my accounts will be 110,000, which will be the depreciable amount, which will be subject to the wear and tear of this asset. Okay, is that understood?
Yes, sir.
So, as per the definition, what is the depreciable amount? It is the cost of an asset or other amount substituted for cost less its residual value. So in calculations, please remember depreciable amount is cost minus residual value. Cost minus residual value. Now based on that, let's look at what is depreciation is. Depreciation is the result of systematic allocation of the depreciable amount of an asset over its estimated useful life. So it's very straightforward now. We have estimated what is the depreciable amount. Going back to the same example, 110,000. This 110,000 has to be allocated over a period of 3 years, which is the useful life of the asset, using some scientific method. What do you mean by that? If you simply look at 110,000 over a period of 3 years means roughly per year, you will have an amount of 35,000. Let me change this example slightly so that it will be understood more easily. 30,000, so this will become 120. Right. Now let's look at it like this. What do you mean by depreciation is, I have changed this example slightly. Let's assume the cost to be 130, residual value to be 10,000. You are using it for 3 years. So your depreciable amount is 130 minus 10,000, which will be 120. Now the question is, what is depreciation? Depreciation is the systematic allocation of your depreciable amount over the useful life, which is the 3 years, 2021, 22, 23. Because 24, you are going to sell it off. Okay. So 21, 22, 23. what will you do? What is your depreciation amount? So if you look at it, for simple understanding, any layman would understand that 120,000 over a period of 3 years means the simplest way that I can do is allocate 40,000 per year, isn't it? 40,000 into 3 means 120. So the simplest way that I can do is to allocate this using 3 years at the rate of 40,000. That will be your depreciation. But unfortunately, you can't do it like that. For this, there should be some scientific method that you can use to depreciate this asset. Okay? That is how depreciation should be provided. You can't just go and add or maybe do depreciation in the way that you like. So depreciation is actually the result of systematic allocation of the depreciable amount of an asset over its estimated useful life. Depreciation for the accounting period is charged to the net profit or loss for the period, either directly or indirectly. So what do you mean by that? Whatever the depreciation charge that you expect, you will go and debit your P&L for that amount. We will look at the double interest later on. So now we come to the definition of carrying amount, and then we'll go to the entity specific value. What is known as carrying amount? It is the amount at which an asset is recognized in the statement of financial position. Statement of financial position, please note that is called the balance sheet. The new name given for this balance sheet is statement of financial position. After deducting any accumulated depreciation and accumulated impairment. Okay, so what I will do is let's take this example. Now, an asset which is worth I'll go with the same example. 130,000 is your cost. Residual value is 10,000. So you know the depreciable amount is 120,000. Okay. So if it is 120,000, let's say the depreciation, allocation of the depreciation, right? This is year one, year two, year three. So I'm using this straightforward method, 40,000 each year. Okay, 40,000 each year. Now, at the beginning, please follow this. It's very important. At the beginning of year one, at the beginning of year one, what is your cost? 130,000. Okay. Now, at this point, what is the carrying amount? I mark it as CA. CA. I mark it as CA. Okay. Carrying amount is also 130. Carrying amount is also 130. Because your cost is 130. Your depreciation is zero. Your depreciation is zero. Now we reach the point where end of year one. End of year one. By the end of year one, your cost is still 130. Your cost is still 130. But now you have a depreciation, which is 40,000. As a result, now what is the carrying amount? Carrying amount is slightly different. Carrying amount is equivalent to cost minus accumulated depreciation. We call that as accumulated depreciation. So in year one, you have a depreciation of 40,000. So your accumulated depreciation is 40,000. Your cost is 130,000. So your carrying amount will be 130,000 is your cost minus 40,000 is your accumulated depreciation. Your carrying amount will be 90,000. Is that understood? Is it clear to you all?
Yes, yes.
Right. Now we get on to year two. So at the beginning of year two, your cost is 130, but your carrying amount is 90,000. Now what is going to happen? Year two also, you have a depreciation of 40,000. Year two also, you have a depreciation of 40,000. So as a result, what do we say? Again, there is a depreciation charge. Again, there is a depreciation charge. So go back to the definition. What is your carrying amount? Carrying amount is cost, which is 130,000, and minus accumulated depreciation. Now, what do you mean by accumulated depreciation? Accumulated depreciation is the depreciation that you have provided up to the point of accounting. From the beginning up to the point of accounting. So now we are in year two. So when you come to the end of year two, your year one depreciation is 40,000. Your year two depreciation is 40,000. So what is your accumulated depreciation? It will be 80,000. Accumulated depreciation is 80,000. But the depreciation for the current year is only 40,000. Only 40,000. So carrying amount will be cost minus accumulated depreciation. So at the end of year two, your cost will be 130,000, but your carrying amount will be 130 minus 80, which will be 50,000. You see? 50,000. Now you go to year three. Year three also, you will provide another 40,000. So what will happen? Your accumulated depreciation will be now 120,000. So cost 130, accumulated depreciation 120. So your carrying amount will be 10,000. Now tell me, what is this 10,000 is? What is this 10,000? Anyone?
Residual value.
Residual value, very good. You see, the residual value is there. So our objective is that if you assign a residual value for this asset, by the end of the useful life of this asset, you should remain with the residual value as your carrying amount. If you assign this to be zero, then your carrying amount will be zero at the end of the useful life of the asset, not at the beginning or maybe halfway through. By the end of the useful life of the asset, if you have not assigned a residual value, your carrying amount should be zero. Your carrying amount should be zero. Is that understood?
Yes, sir.
Right.
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. So just break down this example. And I will want to give you a note also. We will quickly take down that note also. please take down this example. I want to dictate some notes so that you can keep that also for your reference. Okay, so please take down. Based on the above example, based on the above example, based on the above example, the company will account for accumulated depreciation. The company will account for an accumulated depreciation of 120,000. Accordingly, by the end of the useful life, the asset will be having a carrying amount of ₹10,000, a carrying amount of ₹10,000, which is same as the residual value. Assumed by the company at the beginning of the useful life. Next line. The carrying amount is also known as net book value of the asset, also known as the net book value of the asset, which is reported in the balance sheet of the company. Okay, so we'll stop there because it's almost 10. We will continue on this next week. By the time I want you all to revise these definitions, and don't try to memorize them, but try to understand what it means and the applicability of sale. Now I have written certain things in the form of formulas, so I would prefer you all to take the carrying amount is known as the net book value. So take down the formulas also. Carrying amount is equivalent to cost minus accumulated depreciation, right? In other words, net book value is equivalent to cost minus accumulated depreciation. So I don't know whether you are following it. I would prefer if you all can make use of a CR book for this subject, because what will happen is, if when you are taking down notes, sometimes you might be taking down notes in your handout itself, but it would be better if you can take it down in a CR book, so that it will be a continuation of what we are learning. And later on, when we do the question number one and all, you will need a CR book anyway to do the accounts. Okay, so please make sure that you use a CR book or maybe an exercise book to take down notes and as well as do questions. Okay, right. So I'll meet you again next week. A good day to all of you.